Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Katie Weaver and Bryan Lynn. Later, Mario Ritter Jr. and Jill Robbins have this week's education report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
the organization supervising the Olympic triathlon event at the Paris Olympics has postponed the event because of water quality in the Seine River. However, World Triathlon and city officials are hopeful the event, which includes swimming, bicycling, and running, can start on July 31st. World Triathlon is the sport's governing body, overseeing competitions and safety. Its technical and medical team met with the International Olympic Committee and city and local French government officials. They decided to postpone the event because of water quality. Tests in June showed unsafe levels of E. coli bacteria, although results in July showed improvement. Dr. Nicole Iovine is an infectious disease specialist at the University of Florida in Gainesville. She said, while most kinds of E. coli are not harmful, high numbers can be dangerous. The presence of E. coli is a sign that human and animal waste is in water. The World Triathlon Federation considers E. coli levels higher than 900 colony-forming units per 100 milliliters to be unsafe. Swimming in water with unsafe levels of bacteria can lead to feeling sick to the stomach and intestinal problems. Swimmers are likely to swallow water, which can lead to diarrhea. The bacteria can also infect the urinary tract or open cuts. Iovine said, the athletes are young, and they're in the best shape of anybody, but that doesn't mean they can't get sick from these things. Officials are hoping for sunny weather. The ultraviolet light in sunlight can kill bacteria, and higher temperatures bring levels of E. coli and other bacteria in the river water to within safe limits. French Sports Minister Amélie Oudéa-Castéra told French news media on Monday that officials are absolutely serene about all this. She said plans put in place to control the bacterial levels in the river have worked, but the weather was beyond their control. Swimming in the Seine River has been banned for more than 100 years. But Olympic officials wanted to have the swimming part of the triathlon event in the city's famous waterway. So Paris officials spent $1.5 billion to clean up the Seine. Paris is an ancient city, and like many old cities, it has what is known as a combined sewer system. That means the city's wastewater and stormwater flow through the same pipes. When heavy rainfall happens, the pipes carry the extra stormwater along with wastewater into the river instead of a sewage treatment center. As a result, untreated human waste goes directly into the river after heavy rains. Iovine said, bacteria, viruses, and parasites get into the water through human waste, but other things too. It's also wildlife, rodents, for example. When it rains a lot, all of that from those animals can end up in the Seine, she said. To prevent the wastewater overflow, Paris officials built a huge basin next to the Austerlitz train station. It is supposed to capture extra rainwater to keep waste from flowing into the river. They also rebuilt parts of the sewer system and improved water treatment centers. However, heavy rain can still overwhelm the system. The rain that took place during the weekend of the Olympic opening ceremonies filled the basin by 20%. So, officials said the pollution was likely coming from wastewater upstream. If the water quality does not improve, officials are considering holding the event on August 2nd. I'm Katie Weaver.
Rising demand for cooling systems in Nigeria and other African nations might be making existing pollution problems worse. Cooling systems use gases called refrigerants. Such gases can affect the atmosphere if they escape. Some of these pollutants have been found to be more harmful than other kinds of greenhouse gases. The Nigerian government has approved restrictions on the release of refrigerant gases into the environment, but enforcement efforts for the laws have been difficult. Abiodun Ajebi leads an air conditioning business for Samsung West Africa. He told the Associated Press, AP, those laws, those rules, nobody enforces them. Ajebi said one of the biggest problems is a lack of effective education and training about the possible harms of refrigerants. This means many cooling system installers might not follow legal requirements when removing old systems or putting new ones in. Some trained workers do follow environmental rules governing the use of cooling refrigerants. But these kinds of installations cost more. Industry experts and public records suggest the most common air conditioning systems in Africa use a kind of gas known by the trade name R22. This refrigerant is said to be less harmful to the environment than older cooling chemicals known as chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs. CFCs have largely been removed from most modern cooling systems. That change was put in motion by the 1987 Montreal Protocol Environmental Treaty. A document from the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, says R22 is considered many times more damaging to the world's climate than carbon dioxide. For example, about 0.5 kilogram of R22 is said to equal 1 ton of carbon dioxide, the most common greenhouse gas. However, while carbon dioxide can stay in the atmosphere for more than 200 years, R22 stays for about 12 years. R22 cooling equipment is not as energy efficient as some other systems, and most of the electricity used to power R22 coolers in Africa requires carbon-based fuels. Nigeria is planning to ban R22 refrigerants by January 1, 2030. But without enough enforcement, that target is not likely to be met, Samsung's Ajebi told the AP. Some cooling systems use a group of refrigerants called hydrofluorocarbons, or HFCs. These do not harm the ozone layer and are more energy efficient. But HFCs are said to be strong greenhouse gases and account for an estimated 2% of all human-caused warming in the atmosphere. One of the most harmful HFCs, called R410A, is used in the second most common kind of air conditioners in Africa, the AP reported. Sellers and installers of cooling equipment in Nigeria told the news agency that although HFC systems are less damaging to the environment, they are more costly to operate. The same issues are affecting countries beyond Nigeria. In Ghana, the cooling industry also struggles to get companies and workers to obey current environmental rules. I'm Bryan Lynn.
If parents say no when a child asks for a smartphone, the response they are likely to hear is, "Everyone has one. Why can't I?" But what would happen if the child's friends did not have a mobile phone either? That is the way that some parents in Europe are thinking. They are concerned by evidence that smartphone use among young children threatens their safety and mental health. They believe that the more parents join their movement, the more powerful their ideas become.
Parents in Spain, Britain, and Ireland are using social media groups on services like WhatsApp and Telegram to talk about their plans. They want to keep smartphones out of schools. But for their plan to work, other parents have to refuse to buy children the devices before or even into their teenage years. Elizabeth Garcia Permanier got involved after she talked with another parent in a Barcelona park. Last year, she started a social media group to share information on the dangers of the internet with families at her children's school. The group, called Adolescents Free of Mobile Phones, quickly grew and now includes over 10,000 members. The most involved parents are asking other parents to agree not to get their children smartphones until they are 16.
When I started this, I just hoped I would find 4 other families who thought like me. But it took off and kept growing. Growing and growing, Garcia Permanier said. My goal was to try to join forces with other parents so we could push back the point when smartphones arrive. I said, I am going to try so that my kids are not the only ones who don't have one. Police and public health experts have also been voicing concerns about the kind of materials that children can see on their mobile devices. Spain's government took note of the problem and banned smartphones from elementary schools in January. Now, they can only be turned on in secondary school, which starts at age 12, if a teacher deems it necessary for an educational activity. In Britain last year, a 16-year-old girl named Brianna Gay was killed by two teenagers. Her mother demanded that social media on smartphones be limited for children under 16. Mother Daisy Greenwell, who lives in the area of Suffolk, England, and a friend, Claire Reynolds, set up a social media group called Parents United for a Smartphone-Free Childhood. It grew quickly, and an organizer said it now has groups in every British county.
In Greystones, Ireland, 8 primary school leaders, or principals, wrote to parents asking them not to buy their students' smartphones. Then the parents themselves voluntarily signed written agreements promising not to let their young children have the devices. 38-year-old Christina Capatina is a Greystones parent of 2 young daughters. She signed the agreement and said there were almost no smartphones in schools this school year. Studies from Spain, Britain, and Ireland show that by the time children are 12, most have smartphones. In Spain, 25% of children have a cell phone by age 10, and almost 50% by age 11. At 12, this share rises to 75%. British media regulator Ofcom said 55% of children in Britain owned a smartphone between ages 8 and 11, with the figure rising to 97% by age 12. Over recent years, organizations, governments, and parents have been reporting that smartphone use by children is linked to bullying, mental health problems, and loss of the focus necessary for learning. China moved last year to limit children's use of smartphones. France has a ban on smartphones in schools for children aged 6 to 15.
The possible dangers have produced school bans on smartphones and online safety laws. But those measures do not deal with what children do outside of school with mobile phones. Parents and schools that have pushed for changes in their communities saw that it became possible the moment they understood that they were not alone. Rachel Harper is principal of St. Patrick's National School in Greystones. Harper wants parents to work with their local school to organize phone bans. She said, "There's a bit more strength that way, in that all the parents in the area are talking about it." I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Music means it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Andrew Smith, and I'm joined by Dr. Jill Robbins. Hi, Jill.
Hi, Andrew.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Ana introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Ana Mateo.
Lesson 26 of Level 2 of this series is about lookalikes. Lookalikes are two people who look very similar.
But just because two people look alike doesn't mean they act alike. To act alike means to behave in the same way as another person. In today's lesson, you will hear many adjectives to describe two very different kinds of people. Lesson 26 also repeats some expressions and grammar from previous lessons in the series.
Let's listen to Pete and Penelope tell Ana about her look-alike.
Yesterday at work, I met a woman who looks just like you.
Really? Wait, are you making fun of me?
Not this time. She's tall and has curly hair, but even her face looks like yours. I think she's a career consultant.
I bet she has a lot of great advice. I can't wait to meet her.
Yes, you can. I met her, and she is very difficult.
Pete, she's just new. We have to give her a chance. What's her name?
Evelina or something like that. You can't miss her. She always wears a hat.
So, Ana, have you met the new consultant yet?
No, but I've already heard. We look alike, don't we?
Yeah, but you don't act alike. You're much nicer than she is.
Maybe she gets nervous at new jobs, or maybe she's shy. Let's not judge, Penelope.
As usual, Ana tries to be very positive and helpful.
Pete, she's just new. We have to give her a chance.
To give someone a chance means to give them time and opportunities to do well or do good things.
Now, let's see what happens when Ana meets her lookalike.
This is going to be so much fun. Boy, I can't wait to play this game. How much longer are you going to be? We'll just be a minute. You must be Evelina. I'm Ana. We are lookalikes. No, we're not. And my name is pronounced Evelina.
Oh, this is going to be fun.
You had better hurry up. I need this room for a lecture. It's called, If You Want to Win, Others Must Lose. What is all this stuff anyway? It's a game. We're going to play at lunch. It's a stupid child's game. It's a fun game. But yes, it is for children. Well, you may be childish, but I'm not. And you look stupid with that thing on your head. Oh yeah? Well, you look serious with that look on your face. Come on, Pete. Let's go play somewhere else.
Evelina sounds like a terrible person.
She really does. For one thing, she is not polite. Instead of asking nicely, she warns Ana and Pete that they need to finish their game quickly.
You had better hurry up. I need this room for a lecture. It's called, If You Want to Win, Others Must Lose.
As we explained in a recent podcast, the expression had better gives advice in a strong way, almost like a warning. I think of a mother using this expression often.
Yes, or maybe a teacher occasionally. Yes, you'd better do such and such. Also, Evelina says that Ana is childish. Childish has a negative connotation. A connotation is the feeling that people connect to a word.
To be childish means not having good judgment or good control of one's emotions. So it's not a nice thing to say to an adult.
However, there is another word, childlike, which has a more positive connotation. That word refers to the good aspects of childhood, such as being curious, open, innocent, and other qualities.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Earlier, Andrew mentioned that Lesson 26 of Level 2 has grammar that we explained in previous lessons. Listen again to Penelope and Anna and see if you know what verb tense they use in this exchange.
So, Anna, have you met the new consultant yet?
No, but I've already heard.
Did you hear the present perfect tense? Penelope said, "Have you met?" And Anna said, "I've already heard." That tense connects past actions to the present situation.
Now, let's find out more about Evelana. Penelope and Anna are playing a game, and Pete asks to join them. Penelope notices that Pete has a dark circle around his left eye.
Hey, do you guys have room for one more?
Sure, Pete. Come on over. What happened to your eye?
Evil Anna accidentally hit me. And she didn't even say sorry. She's so mean.
I told you so.
Here, Pete, put on this headband. You'll feel better. Penelope, you're right. Evil Anna is an awful person.
And violent. And now we have to work with her.
Haven't you heard? She's gone. She was given another assignment.
In the end, Evil Anna's new job is collecting garbage outside the office.
I guess it doesn't pay to be a mean person.
You are correct. Now, let's talk about more adjectives you can use to describe a good person and a bad person. Anna used the word awful when describing Evil Anna.
Penelope, you're right. Evil Anna is an awful person.
Awful just means very bad. Terrible means the same thing. We can also say that Evil Anna is unkind, self-centered, mean, and thoughtless. Thoughtless means Evil Anna does not think or care about how her actions might hurt other people.
And thoughtful is the opposite of thoughtless. A thoughtful person, like you, Jill, tries to think about what other people need and tries not to hurt their feelings.
Hey, I just follow the golden rule. Treat others the way you want to be treated.
I think that's good advice. Other words to describe nice people include the adjectives caring, generous, cooperative, kind, sweet, and considerate.
Considerate means you take other people's needs and feelings into consideration. In other words, it means the same thing as thoughtful.
So, just like I can say Jill is thoughtful, I can say that Jill is considerate.
And you are too, Andrew.
Well, thank you. I try to be most of the time.
Let's remind our listeners what they can find on our website.
Yes, let's do that. Each lesson of the Let's Learn English series has a lesson plan you can download for free. The plans can be helpful for both students and teachers.
And remember that you can find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.